Good morning, folks. Wonderful to be here to praise God. I know I say it every Sunday, but I mean it. I look forward to coming. I look forward to being together with God's people in worship and prayer and looking into the Word of God together. By the way, there's a few men gather upstairs before the service, if they're not busy running around like me, and praying just before the service. And I think the women are praying in the kitchen. So if you come a little early and you want something to do, step back there or step up there, and 10 minutes of prayer is worth more than 5 hours of me speaking. That's for sure. I'm not planning on speaking 5 hours, though. But I want to sing of my Redeemer, and I trust you do too, because he is a wonderful Savior. A Redeemer, somebody who buys us back from sin. And that's what Jesus Christ has come to do. Let's sing together.
I will sing of my Redeemer and his wondrous love to me. On the cruel cross he suffered, from the curse to set me free. Sing of my Redeemer, with his blood he purchased me, on the cross he sealed my pardon, paid the debt and made me free. I will tell the wondrous story, how my lost estate to save. In his boundless love and mercy, he the ransom freely gave. Sing, oh sing of my Redeemer. With his blood he purchased me. On the cross he sealed my pardon, paid the debt and made me free. I will praise my dear Redeemer, his triumphant power I'll tell, how the victory he giveth over sin and death and hell. Oh sing of my Redeemer, with his blood he purchased me on the cross. He sealed my pardon, paid the debt, and made me free. I will sing of my Redeemer and his heavenly love to me. From death to life that brought me, Son of God within to be. Sing, oh sing of my Redeemer, with his blood he purchased me. On the cross he sealed my pardon, paid the debt, and made me free. Sing, oh sing of my Redeemer, with his blood he purchased me. On the cross he sealed my pardon,
Brother Jack, open in prayer for us.
Lord, we just thank you that we can praise you. Thank you that you died for us. Thank you that we can come together and just worship. Pray you just bless this morning. We'd be able to encourage one another and glorify you. And yes, Lord, you just bless us this morning. In Jesus' name, amen.
How great is our God. He's so awesome. I love him. I praise God. I praise the Lord for the mercy and grace that he gives us.
The splendor of the King, clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice. Let all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide, and trembles at his voice, and trembles at his voice. How great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God, and all will see how great, oh, how great is our God.
Age to age he stands, and time is in his hands, beginning and the end, beginning and the end. God made three in one, Father, Spirit, Son, the Lion and the Lamb, the Lion and the Lamb. How great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God, and all will see how great, oh, how great is our God.
Sing me,
worthy of
Here's an old hymn, what it is to stand before the cross of Jesus. That is, what Christ did on the cross is the center of our Christianity. Take it away and you have nothing left. Because all the moral teachings of Jesus cannot change the sinful heart. Only the cross can bring us there and bring to us a righteousness that is not our own. And that is why, that's where I take my stand. That's why Paul said, God forbid that I should glory except in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ. Beneath the cross of Jesus, I gladly take my stand. The shadow of a mighty rock, within a weary land, a home within the wilderness, a rest upon the way, from the burning of the noontide heat and the burden of the day. Upon the cross of Jesus, my eye at times can see the very dying form of one who suffered there for me. And from my broken heart with tears to wonders I confess, wonders of redeeming love and my unworthiness. I take, O cross, thy shadow for my abiding place. I ask no other sunshine than the sunshine of his face. Content to let the world go by, to know no gain nor loss. My sinful self, my only shame, my glory on the cross. Back to the first verse again. Beneath the cross of Jesus, I gladly take my stand. Shadow of a mighty rock within a weary land, a home within the wilderness, a rest upon the way, from the burning of the noontide heat and the burden of the day. Upon the cross of Jesus, my eye at times can see the very dying form of one who suffered there for me. And from my broken heart with tears to wonders I confess, wonders of redeeming love, my unworthiness. I take, O cross, thy shadow for my abiding place. I ask no other sunshine than the sunshine of his face.
content to let the world go by, to know no gain, no loss. My sinful self, my only shame, my glory all the cross.
Aren't they beautiful words? The beautiful truth that we can stand before Almighty God forgiven. We can say, Lord, I stand amazed to be in your presence, O God, the glory and the wonder of who Jesus is. Kibe.
Before your throne, what can I say? O Holy One, when I think of all that you have done, I worship you, O risen Son. Amazed before you, Lord. I stand amazed. I stand amazed. I stand amazed before you, Lord. I stand amazed. I stand amazed. I think today that I am loved. You shed your blood. My sin is gone. When I know you've come to live in me, and at the throne to see, I stand amazed before you, Lord. I stand amazed. I stand amazed. Stand amazed. I stand amazed. Justified freely by your grace to me. Declared righteous, oh, how can it be? How can it be? Before you, Lord, I stand amazed. I stand amazed. I stand amazed before you, Lord. I stand amazed. I stand amazed. I stand amazed.
Isn't it awesome? Oh, I'll be standing amazed before Jesus for the first 1,000,000 years after I get to heaven. If I just stand in his presence and look at him in the awe and wonder of who he is and give him praise. Because though I am so weak and weary and unable, he is the lifter of my head. He is the one that's paid it all. I hear the Savior say, thy strength in
is small. Child of weakness, watch and pray. Find in me thine all in all. Jesus paid it all to him I owe.
Sin
had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. Lord, now indeed I find thy power and thine alone can change the leper's spots and melt the heart of stone. Jesus paid it all to him my sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. And when before the throne I stand in him complete, Jesus died my soul to save.
I'll still repeat,
Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. Raised this life up from the dead. Oh, praise the one who paid my debt and raised this life up from the dead. Oh, praise the one who paid my debt and raised this life up from the dead. The one who paid my debt and raised this life up from the dead. Oh, praise the one who paid my debt and raised this life up from the dead. Oh, praise the one who paid my debt and raised this life. Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow.
On the cross of Calvary, our blessed Savior died, gave his life to save the world from lies. the blood that stained the old rugged cross. 'Twas his blood, his precious blood, that stained the old rugged cross. 'Twas his love that paid the awful cost. O soul so far astray, come and plunge today in the blood that stained the old rugged cross. To the cross, the rugged cross, they nailed his precious hands. And in death he fully paid the cost. There is pardon in his love for everyone. For the blood that stained the old rugged cross. 'Twas his blood, his precious blood, that stained the old rugged cross. 'Twas his love that paid the awful cost. O soul so far astray, come and plunge today in the blood that stained the old rugged cross. In the blood that stained the old rugged cross. Thank you.
Hello. Hi, everybody. Good morning. Good morning, Marika. Good morning, Stella. Good morning. Oh, what a nice day it is today. Oh, I see Lammy coming. Oh, she's coming kind of in a hurry. Hey, Lammy, you seem to be in a hurry.
Well, I am. I'm running.
Why are you running?
Well, just to kind of get my mind straightened around.
What's going on today?
Well, it's about my older brother.
You have an older brother? I never knew you did.
Yes, I do. His name is John-a-Lam.
John-a-Lam?
Yep, that's his name. John-a-Lam.
Okay. Well, how come I never heard of him before?
Well, I don't like to speak about him.
You don't like to speak about him? How come?
Well, he's been a rascal.
A rascal?
Yep. He took off. A few years ago, off he went. And he left behind his mother and his father and myself, and he never came back, and he never talked to us, and he took a bunch of stuff from the burn, I've been very upset with him.
Well, not very good, eh?
Nope. And now he showed up again.
Well, you must be glad he's back.
Are you kidding? After all that he's done? And he never even once called us or anything, and then we find out that he was living a terrible life out there, and then he got so bad and poor that he was trying to eat dirt, he was so hungry, and then he comes crawling back home like everything is going to be all right.
Whoa, Lammy, slow down a bit.
Yeah, but look at all the things he's done.
And what's making you so angry now?
Well, can you imagine my mama and my papa coming running to him, putting their arms around him and telling to him, oh, we're so glad to have you home, and oh, we love you, and all that.
Well,
Yeah, I can imagine that.
Yeah, but think of all the things he did that were so wrong. They should be saying, you go up behind the woodshed and I'll see you in a few minutes.
Well, maybe you need to think about loving your brother.
Well, I love him, but I don't like him.
Uh-oh. Something wrong with that statement. I hope nobody here has ever said that. That's not a good thing at all, because that's not real love. And your parents were right to forgive him.
Well, he did say he was sorry, but gotta be more than that happened to him.
What do you want to do?
Well, I don't know. Maybe if we put him in the pond for a while and kind of let him go under for a few minutes and then pulled him up and then put him back down again and pulled him up, put him back.
That's enough, Flammy.
It's not fair.
It's not fair?
No. How come he gets all that love and then, oh yeah, you're so wonderful and I'm here and I'm sitting in the corner?
You're sitting in the corner because that's where you want to be. You need to be forgiven.
Me? I don't need it. He's the guy that needs to be forgiven. I've been a good lad.
Uh-oh. You're not a very good lamb right now.
Well, what's wrong? Well, yeah, well, I guess I've been kind of like,
selfish, hateful, unforgiving. You want me to say some more?
Well, no, I think I've heard enough. Oh, boy. Oh, boy. I've just been jealous, too.
Yep.
I was jealous of him because he went away, and now I'm jealous of him because he's back.
You need to ask the Lord to forgive you. You need forgiveness. You need to love your brother. Forgive him. You were with your mother and father all these years, and they looked after you and loved you.
That's true. They did love me very, very much. My mama gave me a kiss and hug, and whenever I would go to bed, she would whisper in my ear, little lammy, I love you, and cuddle me, and it's true.
And your older brother didn't get any of that. Instead, he was eating dirt at the end of it.
Oh, my goodness, I never thought about it like that. I need to go home and give him some love. I didn't even hug him when he got home. I'm going to do that. I'm not even going to go to the milking with you today. I realize how terrible I've been, and God forgives me. He surely will forgive my brother.
Absolutely. You know, sometimes we do get jealous, and we think things aren't fair, and we think we're better than other people. You're no better than your brother was.
I know that now. I thought I was so good, and he was so bad. But I guess we're all bad, aren't we?
We are, and we all need a Savior. That's why we need one. But just like your brother came home, so anybody can come home to God, even if they went way down or if they think they're way up. Both need the same Savior. You do, your brother does, everybody needs the same Savior.
Wow, I guess I'm realizing more and more how much we need Jesus for everything.
Yep. And you better get on home to your brother there. I'm sure he'll be happy to know that you love him and forgive him.
I'm going right now, and I'm going to ask his forgiveness, too, which I never thought I would ever do. But now I see I need to. Thanks, Millie. You're a really good friend, and you're showing me the truth.
Well, I'm glad I can be of help to you. Anyway, I got to go and get milked, or else there's going to be milk on the ground. I got to get going, but I'll be praying for you.
Well, thank you, and I got to get home and see Jonah Lamb. Jonah Lamb, I'm coming home.
You know the old story, the prodigal son, right? I wasn't talking thinking about you, Jonathan. This was the prodigal lamb. But praise God, we have a Savior who takes anybody back, no matter how far you've strayed, no matter how much of a bottom you've hit, and that He doesn't condemn us, but He forgives us. The Father came running for the Son, fell on His neck and kissed Him. That's what God is like. Isn't that beautiful? It's wonderful. We're going to take a few moments for prayer this morning. And especially we want to pray for Alan and Esther and Alan's family. His mother passed away this week. And that's a tender wound, friends. It's a very tender wound when you lose your mother. And it's tender for their whole family. And we want to lift them up before the Lord. Not ideal circumstances. It would be nice to have been by her bedside, but God is in charge of all of those things in these days. And there's about a flood tide of prayer has gone up, went up for her before she left this world. And we have a great hope that she trusted in the Lord. And we want that comfort to be for our brother, whom we love so much, and for his family, for his children, who loved their grandmother, and also the rest of the family as well. So let's come before the Lord. Father, we thank you that we can come in prayer. And we thank you, O God, that, oh Lord, all your people all over the world are so vitally connected to you in prayer. And that, Lord, it doesn't matter. Time and space makes no difference, Lord, when we're in the presence of Almighty God. And so here we are before you, O God. And Lord, we're thankful that we can look to you and trust you for your mercy and grace, that you're righteous and you're full of love and mercy, and that the faintest cry from those who call out to your name will be heard. And so, Lord, we come to you and pray for Alan and for Esther, for their children, Lord. And we pray for family members, Lord, in the depth of grief, Lord, that they're experiencing now, the loss. And we ask for your comfort, Lord. You are called the God of all comfort. And there's no greater comfort than anyone can experience than what comes from you. So we're asking for that comfort today. And we're praying, Father, that Alan would know, Lord, that deep resting comfort from the Lord. But we ask, Lord, for family members who have not trusted in you. And we pray, Father, that they could discover what it is not to sorrow as those who have no hope, but to discover, Lord, a deeper joy, to discover, Lord, the conquering of death through Jesus Christ, to discover, Lord, that the deep comfort, Lord, that comes for those who trust in you goes far deeper than the comfort of this world. Oh, Spirit of the living God, work in a mighty way in all of his family and friends and relatives, Lord, and touch their lives and draw them to Jesus, the Son of God, the light of the world, who stands in full authority over the wall of death and has conquered it completely. So we're asking for that today. And we're so thankful, oh God, that you are here. And that we can turn to you. And that even in the valley of the shadow of death, we find your rod and staff comforting us. Well, we ask for these blessings, Father. And we're looking to you, Lord, to multiply those blessings, Lord, far beyond what we could imagine. May the sound of salvation ring in Alan's family in the days to come, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Amen.
Thank you, brother. Thanks for all the prayers of all my brothers and sisters. And all your love and your messages. We love you right back. Thank you.
Words cannot express the love that we have for one another in the Lord. It's a beautiful thing. Praise God. Today I want to talk about righteousness.
Last week, I talked about salvation by grace. And we saw in Titus chapter 3, verse 5, not by works of righteousness which we have done, but according to his mercy he saves us. And what I want today is to look at a man and see his conversion. You know, everybody's got a story. And those stories can be poignant. They can speak into our lives. They can open our eyes and help us to see. And in the book of Acts, we have the story of a man named Cornelius. And Cornelius was a Gentile. He wasn't a Jew. He wasn't one who was born into the Jewish race. And this is 10 years, okay, chronologically, 10 years after Pentecost. So it was about 10 years after Jesus rose from the dead. And the gospel had gone out through among the Jews. Some had received, many had rejected. And then God, in his grace, opened the door to the Samaritans. And the Samaritans, of course, were half Jew and half Gentile. And it took a lot of persuading for the Jews, believers, to accept that the Samaritans could be saved, because they had become so narrow and prejudiced in their thinking. And now something happens among the Gentiles. And this was like ultra dramatic for the Jewish people. We see that in our story. So in Acts chapter 10, verse 1, there was a certain man in Caesarea called Cornelius. He was a centurion of what was called the Italian regiment. So he was a Roman soldier from Italy. Right? The Italian regiment. But there was something different about this Gentile soldier, this Roman soldier under the Caesar of the day. It says in Acts chapter 10, verse 2, that he was a devout man. He was a devout man. He was one who was a worshiper of God. Not only was he a worshiper of God, it says he feared God with all of his household. And not only that, but he gave alms generously to the people and prayed to God always. You see, he was not a worshiper of the pagan idols of Rome. He was a worshiper of the God of the Jews, who is the God of all. It was just that God used the Jewish people to bring the message to the world. And the Jews kind of took that and exalted themselves far above where they should have been. They were just messengers. God is the God of the entire world, and that was prophesied over and over again in the Old Testament. But sadly, the Jewish people of the day, the leaders especially, had rejected that idea and thought it was all about them. To the point when Jesus actually addresses them and says, listen, you're of your father the devil, because of the works of the devil, that's what you do. We are Abraham's children, they said. And God, that's when Jesus told them, you're of your father, the devil. Sadly, many of them had turned away from God and had looked at their own righteousness. But here's a Gentile, and listen what it says about him. He was devout. He feared God. He obviously brought his whole household to the Lord. He gave generously to people, and he was praying to God all the time. Now, if you met someone who is of this character, of this walk, what would you assume about them? Would you say, there's a believer if there ever was one? Wouldn't you say? There's someone who is saved. There's someone who has trusted in the Lord. You would say, well, you know, this guy's got it made. But listen to what it says about the ninth hour of the day. He saw clearly in a vision an angel of God coming in and saying to him, Cornelius. And when he observed him, he was afraid, and he said, what is it, Lord? So he said to him, your prayers and your alms have come up for a memorial before God. Now, what does that mean? What it means is that God saw his devotion, and God saw his seeking heart. Now, it doesn't mean that he was saved. Let me explain that. It doesn't mean he was saved, because if it did, the rest of the story wouldn't have happened. But what it means is that he was a seeker of God. And hallelujah, does it say in the Word of God, if you seek, you shall find? Does it not say in the Old Testament, if you seek for me with all your heart, you shall find me? Doesn't it say that? Now, Cornelius didn't have as much light, perhaps as some of the Jews did, but he had enough light to know that God was real and that he needed God. And he wanted God. And I can tell you, friends, anybody who wants God can find him. If you search for me with all your heart, you will find me, says the Lord. Now, I have no doubt that God is previous, for he always is. That God was working in Cornelius' heart and preparing his heart and doing all these things. And God's the master orchestra. What's the guy that runs the orchestra? Maestro, right? He's the master maestro. And he is organizing things so amazingly. So now the angel appears. He says, now send men to Joppa. And send for Simon, whose surname is Peter. He's lodging with Simon, a tanner, whose house is by the sea. He will tell you what you must do. Then why didn't the angel just tell him? Why didn't the angel just say, okay, here's what you need to do? Why did he have him send for Peter? Any answers? What's that? The angel's not God, but he could have said it. Angels are messengers. What is he? Go through all these details. You got to go and find Peter, send him, bring, and then Peter's got to come to you and tell you what you need to, what you must do, what you must do. God has committed the evangelization of others to us, friends, not to angels. He's given you that responsibility to be ready to give an answer for the hope that you have within you. He's given you that opportunity to share the good word of Almighty God. And that's why he says, now I want you to go and get Peter. Furthermore, God had told Peter, I'm going to give you the keys to the kingdom. And those keys were the opening of the gospel to the Samaritans. Peter had to go down to the Samaritans. And now Peter was coming to open the gospel to the Gentiles. You see, it was the commissioning that came from Jesus Christ, and it was being fulfilled. So when the angel who spoke to him had departed, Cornelius called two of his household servants and a devout soldier from among those who waited on him continually. So when he had explained all these things to them, he sent them to Joppa. The next day, as they went on their journey and drew near the city, Peter went up on the housetop to pray. It was about the sixth hour, which is high noon, by the way. There's a little word there for you, friends. Pray. Find yourself praying. And the Jews did have this habit of praying at the third hour of the day, the sixth hour of the day, the ninth hour of the day, taking time to stop and pray. I think perhaps it wouldn't do us any harm to find ourselves setting aside time. Peter went out on the housetop to pray. What does that tell you? He went to be alone with God. We live in a world where, I shouldn't say we're never alone. We are alone plenty, but we fill our heads. We're constantly watching something on the phone, on the computer. It's always around us. If we're not around people, we're filling our minds constantly. We got music playing here. We've got somebody speaking there. We've got a show to watch there. And then we've got TikTok and Tactic or whatever it is. And we just carry on, right? We just fill our minds with stuff. And we're on information overload in our society. I'm one of them. I'm a junkie. And I have to watch myself. I need time apart, alone, and away from God, from all this other stuff to be with God. And you need it. And if you don't take it, you will find yourself barren at times. And you'll find yourself, yeah, filled with a lot of stuff. But where's the rest? Where's the peace? Where's the power? Where's the presence of God? Peter went up on the housetop to pray. I don't expect to drive by your house and see you sitting on the roof, okay?
But, you know, those houses were flat, and there was a stairs that went up to the top of them. But he found a quiet place. Doesn't that seem obvious? To pray, to seek God. And then he became very hungry, and he wanted to eat. But while they made ready, he fell into a trance. Now, it may very well be, it sounds like he was actually fasting and praying, and finally it came to time to break that fast, and he must have let them know at the house, because they were making the food ready, and while that was happening, he falls into a trance. And he saw heaven opened, and an object like a great sheet, bound at the four corners, descending to him and let down to the earth. In it were all kinds of four-footed animals of the earth, wild beasts, creeping things, and birds of the air. And a voice came to him, said, "Rise, Peter, kill and eat." Now, this isn't our culture today, is it? But if you go to third world countries, you go to the market, you want a chicken, a lot of times they pull out a live chicken, right? And you take the live chicken and they cut the head off it, and then they pluck the feathers off of it, and it's still warm, and they eat it. They cook it and they eat it. And so it wouldn't have been like a strange thing to kill and eat when it was time to eat. They didn't have fridges and refrigerators and freezers and all that kind of stuff. They just, food was often eaten right on the spot as it was killed. So he said, "Rise, Peter, kill and eat." But there was a problem. You see, the animals that had been let down in the sheet were considered unclean animals, and they were listed as unclean animals in the Old Testament. And here's God telling him, "Rise, Peter, kill and eat." Peter said, "Not so, Lord. I've never eaten anything common or unclean." "Oh, Lord, I can't do this." So a voice spoke to him the second time, "What God has cleansed, you must not call common." This was done three times. And then the object was taken up into heaven again. This was a vision, okay? What did it mean? I know we're not supposed to eat those, you know, there were certain animals you weren't supposed to eat in the Old Testament. They had to have the hoof cloven. Pigs were out of the question. So there was likely a big pig in the sheet there, right? You eating a pig would have been just like, oh, that's out of this world. Three times, God says, "Kill and eat." "No, I can't. I can't eat anything unclean." "Kill and eat. What God has cleansed, don't you call common or unclean." "I've never eaten anything like that." Now, while Peter wondered within himself at this vision, what had this meant? Behold, a man who had been sent from Cornelius had made an inquiry for Simon's house, and they stood before the gate, and they called and asked whether Simon, whose surname was Peter, was lodging there. While Peter thought about the vision, the Spirit said to him, "Behold, three men are seeking you. Arise, therefore, go down and go with them, doubting nothing, for I have sent them." Peter went down to the men who had been sent to him from Cornelius and said, "Yes, I'm he whom you seek. What reason have you come? For what reason have you come?" And they said, "Cornelius, the centurion, a just man." So now we discover a little bit more about him. He was a just man, one who fears God, and has a good reputation among all the nations of the Jews, was divinely instructed by a holy angel to summon you to his house and to hear words from you. Now, I'm going to jump to Acts 11:12 for a moment, because this is Peter telling the story afterwards, and we have a little bit more detail. That's just how it is sometimes. Not all the detail is in one part, but we find it somewhere else. And here's what Peter was, as he was recounting the event in Acts 11:12, he says, "The Spirit told me to go with them, doubting nothing. Moreover, these six brothers came with me, and we entered into the man's house." That's Cornelius' house. "And Cornelius, he told us how he had seen an angel standing in his house who said to him, 'Send men to Joppa and call for Simon, whose surname is Peter, who will tell you words by which you and all your household will be saved.'" What do you mean? This was a man who was feared God, prayed, gave money. He was like an awesome guy. You ever hear somebody say, "Well, if that nobody's in heaven, if that person's not in heaven for all the good things they have done"? I've heard that a few times in my life, haven't you? All that Cornelius was and all that Cornelius did still left him unsaved. It had to have, because what does it say here? He will tell you words by which you and all your household will be what?
Saved.
So all the religious practice, all the good deeds that we do, and all the giving that we might have, and the fearing of God, and the desire for God, is not salvation. None of it is bad. Obviously, God saw his heart, and because he saw his hungering heart and his desirous heart, God met him in the road of life, sending the angel, sending Peter, but he needed to be saved. He needed to be rescued. And friends, people need to be saved. They need to be saved. Nothing less than salvation will do. No matter how close we come, no matter how close we think we come, our righteousness cannot save us. And now Cornelius is faced with this challenge, and he meets that challenge. He says, I sent these people for Peter. He wants to hear the message. And we, as it says in Acts 11:15, as I began to speak, Peter said, the Holy Spirit fell upon us at the beginning. But let's go back to Acts 11. Oh yeah, this is the same here. Acts 11:16. Then I remember the word of the Lord, how he said, John indeed baptized with water, you'll be baptized with the Holy Spirit. If therefore God gave them, the Gentiles, the same gift as he gave to us, and we believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, who is I that I could withstand God? And so actually Peter baptized them after that. Let's go back to Acts 10 for a moment, verse 34. And it says, Peter opened his mouth and said, in truth I perceive God shows no partiality. God is not partial. It doesn't matter if you're young or if you're old, if you're rich or poor, if you're whatever nationality you are. I can tell you that it seems like racial division has grown so rapidly in Canada and the United States, it's incredible. Now, I'm saying racial division, and I'll tell you what racial division is producing. It's producing racism. The racial division is producing racism. The promotion of one race above another. We should be blind to race at all times. I shouldn't see whether someone is black or whether someone is white. That is not right, or whether whatever they are. No nationality. There should be no prejudice. It should be level ground. That's exactly what we see here. God shows no partiality, and neither should we in any way. There is no glorying in being black, and there's no glorying in being white. There's glorying in being a created being from God whom we rejoice in and whom we look to for life and for all things. But in every nation, whoever fears him and works righteousness is accepted by him. This is not telling us that we are saved by our righteousness. It's telling us that the work of God is to redeem people. It doesn't matter who they are. The emphasis here is on who they are, because remember the prejudices that the Jews had toward the Gentiles. And now that prejudice was being knocked down and Peter's eyes were being opened. God can save anybody and cause them to worship him, to fear him, and to work righteousness. And it doesn't matter what nationality they're from. The word of God, which God sent to the children of Israel, preaching peace through Jesus Christ, he is Lord of all. That word you know, which was proclaimed throughout all Judea and began from Judea, from Galilee after the baptism which John preached. Now he says that word you know, which means that the message of the gospel had gone out and that even Cornelius would have been familiar with it. How God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power, who went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil, for God was with him. What a summary statement of Jesus and who he was. And we are witnesses of all things which he did, both in the land of the Jews and in Jerusalem, whom they killed by hanging on a tree. Him God raised up on the third day and showed him openly, not to all the people, but to witnesses chosen before by God, even to us who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. Just a side note, some would have said, why didn't Jesus show himself to all of Israel at that time? We maybe not have the full answer to that. But do you remember at one point they wanted to grab Jesus and make him a king? Why? Because he gave them free bread. If the unsaved, unregenerated, who didn't care about who Jesus really was, if all of them saw that he was risen from the dead, they would have said he's the Messiah. But not the spiritual Messiah. They would have rose up and caused a great rebellion against Rome. They would have been willing to die for him, but never really being converted. Do you see the problem? You see how it is? How the unsaved world take even the greatest blessing and turn it into a curse. God is wise in what he did, in who saw. There were 500 people who saw him risen from the dead at once. Anyway, I'm digressing here. He says, and he commanded us to preach to the people and to testify. It is he who was ordained by God to be judge of the living and the dead. To him all the prophets witness that through his name, whoever believes in him will receive what? The remission of sins. Isn't that amazing? And when they heard these things, they became silent and they glorified God. This was in Acts 11:18. God has granted to the Gentiles repentance to life. Friends, God saves. And he saves all kinds. And it is vitally important for us to understand that there is no way that we are saved by our own righteousness. We cannot be. You know, anybody ever heard John Wesley? Anybody heard his name? Yeah. John Wesley, he was actually the founder of the Methodist movement. And John Wesley was a preacher. John Wesley was a very religious man, a church member, a minister, the son of a minister. He belonged to a religious club at Oxford, the purpose of which was the perfecting of the Christian life. Now, they had meetings where they were very diligent. I mean, they were strict about themselves to serve God the best way that they could. They were extremely religious and extremely devout. They'd put me to shame 1,000 times over. They were disciplined. I'm not. I'm chaos. Ask my wife. But they were disciplined and extremely disciplined about prayer, about Bible study, about walking with God, about doing the best for the master and serving him and living a holy life. Oh, diligent about every little thing. Close and careful. Wesley felt so convinced and convicted about serving God that he went out to be a missionary, a foreign missionary. But here's the thing. With all of that religious practice, he had no assurance of his own salvation. He had no peace about himself being saved. He went on board a ship bound for the Georgia colony in early 1736, and a ferocious storm shredded the mainsail and flooded the decks. Many of the English passengers aboard screamed in terror as they would soon be swallowed up by the deep. But there was a group of Moravian missionaries from Germany. Now, Moravia was actually a part of where Czechoslovakia is today. And in Moravia, there were believers who had come to faith through the powerful ministry of John Huss. And John Huss was a man who walked with God. He was martyred for his faith. He was burnt at the stake for his faith in God. But it caused the stirring of people who came to faith in Christ. And then, of course, Martin Luther eventually became a believer, and he was persecuted. But there became a freedom after Martin Luther, when Germany separated from the power of Catholicism at the time, which was the main persecutor of believers. And these Moravian believers became very devout, and then there was a man named Count Zinzendorf. And Count Zinzendorf was a devout man. And he had small groups of believers meeting and praying and seeking God, but they preached a clear gospel of salvation. Now, the Moravians sent missionaries all over the world to remote places. As a matter of fact, the Moravians went to Labrador. Can you imagine? And they went to Labrador, and they preached in the little remote villages of Labrador the gospel of Jesus Christ, and many came to faith as a result of that. And actually, Dr. Thomas, who was a doctor in Inverness, who retired from Labrador, he wrote a book called From Sled to Satellite. And it's the accounts of his ministering with the Moravian mission was still in effect, just not that long ago. But here were the Moravian missionaries from Germany calmly singing throughout the squall. They were unafraid of death. And John Wesley was absolutely astounded by it. He wrote in his journal. He couldn't understand how could they have such peace in the face of death coming over them. And I have no peace, and I'm the missionary. I'm the preacher. The interesting thing about the Moravians, they weren't ordained ministers with all the letters before their name. They were simple folk who went around the world with the gospel. And they saw mighty conversions. That journey marked Wesley's first significant encounter with a small group that had an enormous influence on his ministry and the Methodist movement that he started. 2 years later, a disheartened Wesley, completely discouraged, because he saw no fruit for his missionary endeavors. He was going to go and change. He was going to cause mighty conversions among the native people. He came back empty-handed, defeated and discouraged, wrestling with his Christian faith after a miserable time in Georgia. And on May 24, 1738, friends prevailed upon him to attend a Moravian, there they are, society meeting in Aldersgate Street in London. He reluctantly went. He attended that small meeting where someone was reading aloud from Martin Luther's commentary on the book of Romans. At about 9:15, Wesley wrote in his journal, he was very meticulous. While he was there listening, he described the change which God works in the heart through faith in Christ. I felt my heart strangely warmed. I felt I did trust in Christ, Christ alone for my salvation, and an assurance was given to me that he had taken away my sins, even mine, and saved me from the law of sin and death. And the result of that conversion was the great Wesleyan revival that swept not only many into the kingdom of God, but transformed the entire British society through Christian social action. Our God saves. Religion doesn't. All that we think we can do for God, all our devoutness, is not what God wants. He wants you to put your faith and your trust in Jesus Christ alone for salvation, and by all means be devout. By all means serve Him fervently. But do you see the difference? He was like Cornelius. All that he had and all of his devotion and all that he was going to do for God had to go by the wayside. And he had to fall on his face and trust in the Lord. There was many of interaction after that between Wesley and Count Zinzendorf. And much of the blessing of Wesley's ministry came from this work of the Moravian missionaries. But we don't have to look far to find this again. Look in Philippians chapter 3, verse 4. The Apostle Paul says this, though I also might have confidence in the flesh, If anyone else thinks he may have confidence in the flesh, I more so. Paul says, listen, I was the ultimate religious person. I was circumcised the eighth day of the stock of Israel. I was of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew of the Hebrews. And concerning the law, a Pharisee. These were all markers that said, whoa, Paul, you're awesome. Concerning zeal, nobody was more zealous than I, Paul says. I was persecuting the church. That was supposed to be a good thing, you see. Because the church, this Jesus radical stuff was all garbage, and we need to get rid of them, and Paul was actually consenting to being people being put to death. Concerning the righteousness which was in the law, I was blameless. Nobody could say, hey, Paul, you're not keeping the law right there. Paul, you're not doing things just quite right there. Paul, I saw you. You didn't wash your hands before you ate something unclean. Nope. I was blameless. I was meticulous, Paul says. I was devout. I was zealous. I was all these things. I was in it for God 150%. But then he says, what things were gained to me, I counted loss for Christ. Everything that people looked at, everything that people thought, everything that I thought was so devout and religious, I counted it all loss for Christ. Yes, indeed, I count all things loss for the excellence of the knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things, and I count them as rubbish that I may gain Christ. And then he says this, and be found in him, not having my own righteousness. I got rid of my own righteousness, says Paul, which is from the law. But that which is through faith in Christ, the righteousness which is from God by faith. And he says that about the very Jews when he says in Romans 10:1, brother, my heart's desire and prayer to God for Israel is that they may be saved. For I bear them witness, they have a zeal for God, but it is not according to knowledge. They're zealous, but in the wrong way. Like Wesley, zealous. Like Cornelius, zealous. Like Paul, zealous. I just want to point out today especially, we often point to the dying thief and say, oh, God can save a wretch like him. John Newton, slave trader, wicked man, amazing grace, how sweet the sound, that saved a wretch like me. But then let's think about the religious ones, the self-righteous ones, the ones who are zealous, the ones who are devout, and pray every day and try and do their best. Just as much the wretch. Just as much needing the Savior. And praise God, he's available for both. Yes, those were they were ignorant of God's righteousness and sought to establish their own righteousness, which not submitted to the righteousness of God. For Christ is the end of the law for righteousness to everyone who believes. I go back to a passage that I used last week, and I want to mention it again. Because the word that strikes me in this passage is many. The word is many. And that word many is earth-shattering. Because many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, which means they acknowledge the Lordship of Jesus. Okay? First thing. Even emphasize, Lord, Lord, we were preachers in your name. We prophesied in your name. That's quite a thing, isn't it? We cast out demons in your name. We did many wonders in your name. Many. Many. And I'll say, declare to them, I never knew you. Depart from me, you who practice lawlessness. That's devastating. Not few, but many. That ought to cause us to stop and realize and consider. And whoever's listening to this, you need to stop and consider. Do not think that you could trust in what you have done for God and what you think you've done for God and all that you have, that you offer up to Him. He says, lawlessness, lawlessness, all your righteousness are filthy rags. You need the righteousness of Christ. There's no hope anywhere else, friends. It's absolutely, utterly hopeless without the righteousness of Jesus. These people were not true believers. Some have said, oh, they lost their salvation. No, it says, I never knew you. I never knew you. I didn't say, I knew you once when you were doing these things, but now I don't know you. That's not what it says. I never knew you. You were never mine. And the reason why they were never His is because they never came to the cross, because they never repented, is because they were still there before the throne of God offering up their own righteousness, their acts to God and saying, Lord, look at what we've done. And God says, you're not getting saved by what you've done. The only way you're getting saved is by what I've done. The only true blessed assurance anyone can ever have is by the work of Jesus Christ on the cross. You will not find it in your works. Wesley discovered it. Paul discovered it, Cornelius discovered it, and you need to discover it, and so do I. This is the only way. I'm not going to stand before Almighty God and tell Him, Lord, Lord, I preached in Shetty Camp. Is He going to check? Lord, some people got saved when I preached. Check. Okay, that looks pretty good. I think you're going to get in. No way, friends. There's only one check mark. Christ died for my sins. Has He died for yours? Have you actually trusted Him? If I asked you today, are you saved? Are you sure of your salvation? Can you say absolutely? Or do you start going like this? Well, gee, I don't know if I could say that. I'm not that good. You're looking at yourself. You're presenting your works. You're presenting your righteousness. You're thinking about your righteousness. Abandon your righteousness. No, you're not that good. No, you're just absolutely awful. You need a Savior and you need His righteousness and His alone. But hallelujah! The work's been done. Christ died for our sins. The salvation that He's offered is ours. He made Him to be sin for us who knew no sin. So we become the righteousness of God in Him. He's done it, and He's done it well. There's your salvation, friends. If there's a doubt in your mind today, if somehow you have been wiggling your way along with a little bit of religion and a little bit of faith, you're thinking, well, you know, I think I'm going to be all right. You know, I've been a good guy. I've done my best. I've tried. I've done. If let me call out in mercy and grace towards you. Abandon it all. Forsake it all and come now and trust in the blood of Jesus Christ alone and know your salvation. Because when it's Christ alone, then you know your salvation. If it isn't, then you won't. You'll be living in constant consternation. If men who have been so devout and so religious had defined the cross and salvation, then so do you. Young or old, it doesn't matter. We need the Lord Jesus Christ. I so long to read another little story to you, but my time is almost gone, but I'm going to do it anyway, so.
I have a question here.
Yes. Please.
It's funny that you brought up this topic today. We've discuss it in our ladies' meeting, and it's a question. I came home Thursday, mm-hmm. asking myself if I'm truly saved.
Okay.
And I think you answered that question, but for my own clarification, are you saying to be saved, I just need to believe and trust in God alone?
In Christ and His salvation that is given to us in the cross, yes. There's a repentance, a willingness to turn from sin, and faith in Jesus Christ. That's why the Bible says, what must I do to be saved? Believe in the Lord Jesus Christ and shall be saved.
believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. It means to trust God. Yes, Lord, I trust in you alone. That's salvation. It's not what I do for God.
No, I know. I'm not going with a list.
Yes.
They have done that or done this or not.
Amen.
I just wanted to know because I went home and I asked them, you know, are you saved? Are you sure you're saved? You said you had a dream, but you won't get into that. But
sure.
Yes, so it's good to know that we're in alignment with God.
Amen.
I went home, I asked the question,
amen.
I searched for answered, and you answered it. So
hallelujah.
Thank you for your word.
Amen. Yeah.
Praise God.
It's so good to know. It's life. There's no life anywhere else, friends. It's reality. Salvation is real. But it is a salvation that is from God, not from us. Praise God. It's wonderful. It's so awesome. Praise his name. This is a I have to summarize this, and I'm having a hard time doing it, but Mr. McPherson, who was brought up in Margaree. And I've read some of this before to you. He was brought up in Margaree. And as a matter of fact, Ralph McPherson, who runs the store in Margaree Valley next to the Baptist Church, this would have been his uncle. And he wrote a book back in 1925. He gives an account when he was 13 years old. And Mr. Foster came in the late 1890s, and he came to preach at the church. And the story of that is amazing in itself. And as he began to preach, people began to flock to hear the messages. And God swept through the whole community in a marvelous way, and many were saved. There were 60 or 70 people who got saved, and families, and wicked men in the community. And it was during the harvest time, and they left their fields, the harvest, and came to the church, and the church was so full that the people were outside with the windows open listening to him preach. As a matter of fact, there were two men who were way up in Cape North country, and they were teaching. They had a contract to teach up in Cape North. No roads, right? Footpaths through the mountains. And as they were teaching, both of them met each other, had a chat. They were in two different schoolhouses, and they felt they had to go home, and they didn't know why. And it just grew on them, and they went to the board, and the board told them, the school board that was there, said, you're just homesick, stay here and preach and teach. No, they had to go. So they set by foot over the mountains, 60 miles through the mountains, and walked up to Margaree. And on the way, it was a long journey by foot across the mountains of Cape Breton. But finally, on reaching a French settlement on the coast of Margaree Harbor, on the west side of the island, they went into a farmer's house for dinner. On learning of their home in the northeast valley of Margaree, their host said, have you heard of the revival of religion in Margaree? No, they replied. Well, they've all gone crazy up there over religion, said the Frenchman. The boys arrived home and on that same night told their thrilling story to the congregation, and they declared they knew nothing of this revival, but that God had called them home, and there they yielded their lives to Christ. And these two teachers returned to resume their work in their respective schools, but later entered the Christian ministry. God at work arranging things. See? Just like Cornelius. Isn't it amazing how God works? Now, this man who wrote the story at 13 years old says, I attended all of the services during the revival, but it was not till the second week I decided to pray and seek salvation. I had a chum whose name, let us say, was Frank, and nightly we went together to the services. I urged Frank to take a stand and confess Christ, but he always replied, no, if you will, I will. I'd nudge him in the ribs, boy-like, with my elbow and say, go on, you're older than I. When you get up and confess Christ, then I shall. Frank nudged back and said, no, if you will, then I will. Night after night, the nudging continued with the same result. What Foster did is in the meetings, he gave people an opportunity just to stand and say anything that was on their heart. And many would stand and say, I've come into the light. I've seen, I've been saved. And some would say, pray for me. I want to be saved. I want to tell you, if you want to do that any time in the middle of a meeting, if you've got something to say, I'm so happy to hear somebody ask a question or say something. Because we interact with one another, and we learn from one another. And so there was this wrestling going on between Frank and George McPherson. He says, I spent much of the time during the days of this week digging potatoes in an obscure part of the old farm where I was unseen by the neighbors. It was a narrow wedge-like patch coming to a sharp point. At one end of the rows, potatoes ran crosswise. I began to dig at the narrow point, and at the completion of each row, I knelt down on the ground to pray for light and leading, promising God he would give me strength to confess his son before men. I would do so that night. Prayer was answered. And that night, without speaking a word to my chum, I rose in the service and I said, pray for me. I desire to know Jesus Christ. It was no easy cross to bear. Nevertheless, in resuming my seat, I felt much relieved. I believe a good service was performed, and I put myself in the way of blessing. And I love that little statement. I put myself in the way of blessing. Cornelius had put himself in the way of blessing. Here he was in the way of blessing. And Mr. Foster's text that night was, whoever shall be ashamed of me and my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, the Son of Man will be ashamed of him when he comes in the glory of his Father with the holy angels. I knew I had done what I could. So far, so good, but I experienced no special change in my life. Converts told how they came into the light, but I had no such testimony. On returning to my home, I left my chum at the wagon road and took a short cut across the backlands over a small footpath. It was one of the great nights in that northeastern climb. The milkmaid's path was in full bloom. The sky was ablaze and the myriads of stars seemed like gimlet holes in the sky to let the glory through. Old language, but poetic. Coming along the path to where a cherry tree lay across the cap, though it lost the way, I sat thereon and removed my homespun cap, and looking up I worshipped the good Creator for having made such a wonderful, beautiful world for men. I thank God for his marvelous universe and for his goodness, but I still had not come into the light. What is the light of which I'd heard so much in the revival? My worship at that time, I fancy, was like a devout Jew or Unitarian or Mohammedan or member of some secret society who with the mind seeks to worship the great Creator, even through his works by aid of symbols and suggest in some way the fact of God. I think I was in the same attitude in mind and heart toward God as many in their churches worship by means of symbols or rituals only. So he says, you know, I was trying to worship God, and I acknowledged he was there, but that's not salvation. That's not coming into the light. Though I did not feel I was a great sinner, nevertheless I had a consciousness of sin, and this was the thing which I sought freedom from. With an intellectual conception of God, I tried to thank him for his goodness. But to me this was not salvation, for I had no sense of peace, no rest, and no consciousness of freedom from sin. Someone has said the greatest question a man can ask is, how can a guilty man be just with God? This is what I long for, to be right with God and to know this beyond a doubt. This is salvation, friends. It is not the worship of God that leaves out the cross. While sitting on the tree across the trail, my mind turned toward Jesus Christ. I now ceased from praying. I was quietly meditating on Christ, and in this I thought of his cross. I lay no claim to having a special vision, but I did visualize Jesus in the long ago dying on the cross, robed in blood and awful agony as he cried, Father, forgive them, and it is finished. Christ was there on the cross as real to me as if I was present when he died. And with this vision of him, I became aware for the first time of my unbelief, of the sin of not believing in him who died as my substitute. And instantly I cried aloud, Lord, I believe. And as quick as the lightning flash, there came a flood of peace and joy, full and satisfying deep down at the bottom of my life. And I became as restful as the surface of a mountain pool. What was it? It was the voice of God in my soul giving me the new consciousness of forgiveness, of salvation, free, full, complete, simply because I believed on Jesus Christ. I was aided by the unseen Spirit to cast myself upon his finished work. Now I knew I was saved, born from above by the power of an endless life. I was completely satisfied. I know I met God and found him, or better, he found me at the cross. I arose and went on my way singing as loudly as I could in the silent, solemn hour of that glorious night. There is a fountain filled with blood drawn from Emmanuel's veins, and sinners plunge beneath that flood, lose all their guilty stains. On retiring that night, I wondered whether I should wake in the following morning, feeling the former indifference to God. I feared that the rest of brain and nerves might affect the change in my spiritual enjoyment. But on the next morning, the consciousness of God was as real as the night before, and instantly on rising, I dropped upon my knees to pray. I was as changed in the morning as on the previous night, and this confirmed me in the conviction that my experience in the backlands was not a mere gush of emotion or self-hypnotism or the effects of mind influence resulting from nightly contact with services. Formerly, prayer was forced, and now it's perfectly natural, easy, delightful, and glorious, a very conscious communion of God. Next to Jesus Christ, whom I met on the footpath, I thought of Frank and wondered whether he would give himself to the Master as I did. Mr. Foster preached the final sermon in the revival from the text, "The harvest is past, the summer is ended, and you're not saved." It breaks my heart. It breaks my heart that people tarry, they don't come. Because the day will come when the harvest will be past, the summer will be ended, and you won't be saved. That day will come. Frank, who was present, was still rejecting God's call. Time flew on at a rapid pace. Frank, like hundreds of other young men, left Cape Breton for the West. The last I heard of him, he was shot dead in the barroom of a small hotel which he was conducting, and his remains were buried just outside the place where the dear fellow met his tragic end. When I heard the sad death of this most promising young life, for Frank was one of the popular and beloved youth of Margree, my thoughts went back to the hour of momentous decision in the Baptist church when I accepted and poor Frank rejected the invitation to become a follower of Christ. Here came the parting of the way. It seemed a very simple thing for a mere lad only 13 years of age to take a stand for Christ. Nevertheless, that act decided my future life and destiny. It was the beginning of my acquaintance with God. Frank was as worthy, yea, often I thought more worthy than I. But he made a fatal decision. Well, I chose the better way. Dear good friend Frank, shall we ever meet again? The gospel. Only the gospel. Only salvation through the cross of Jesus Christ, the only righteousness we can ever have. May God touch our lives. May he touch anyone that's watching this or hearing it anywhere and realize I must come to Christ now. I must put myself in the way of blessing. I must seek the Lord while he may be found. I must call upon him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake his way and the unrighteous man his thoughts. Turn to the Lord and he will receive you. Call on his name. Make sure that you are saved. If you've got doubt or question in your mind, make sure of salvation. Seek the Lord. Get on your knees and cry out to him. Believe in the Lord Jesus Christ and you shall be saved. Don't tarry. Don't delay. Your eternal destiny depends upon it. Do not count on how much services you have been to. Do not count how much Bible you know, how much prayer you know, or whether your parents are Christians or whether they're not Christians. Don't count on anything else except the shed blood of Jesus Christ on the cross. It is there where you can set your hope. It is there where you can have a foundation that can never be moved. It is only there. It is your only righteousness. Abandon every other thing. Seek the Lord, and you will discover a salvation that is sure and one that is secure. The reason why there's such insecurity in salvation with so many people is because they have not found their resting place at the cross. They have tried to find it somewhere else. And thank God there is nowhere else. There's no other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. Father, Lord, I thank you today for the gospel, and I thank you for its truth. I thank you for its burning power. Lord, I bless your name, that I know that the preaching of the cross is the power of God for salvation. I know this, Lord. I know that your spirit is here in power. And I know that you're calling people to true repentance and faith in Jesus Christ. And I pray today that people people will be saved. Not halfway, not dilly-dally, but truly converted. I cry out in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen.